Meng and Shu. He is CEO Connect Blockchain.
Yeah, Robert. So we like every members to give a brief introduction, except Ken Coghill, and because everybody knows him very well. So we can start with Robert. You can give a small introduction about Bitfinex. Yeah, it's already started. Yeah.
I guess we start at this slide, preparing for institutional players. Or let me start with introducing myself. My name is Robert. I'm from Bitfinex. I will introduce Bitfinex here a little bit. And with the topic preparing for institutional players and institutional clients. Starting with an agenda, talking a little bit about history, institutional preparation, OTC and secondary market. So Bitfinex started in 2012. We are a crypto exchange. We have a large option for spot and margin trading. Well, highly functional exchange or API and our engine works even when others overload. So we can handle up to 10,000 trades a second, or that's what we do on average, up to 150,000 a second over all the currencies. And the team is growing and currently is 110 people. Now, we have Bitfinex Pro, which is for institutional clients. Let's start with the easy things, like we have our own server in a Swiss data center. We are not reliable on external sources like Amazon or Google Cloud. We offer co-locations for institutional traders, so they can do high volume trading with close to zero ping in between. Those institutional traders also have sub-accounts, which, well, is explained on the slides what the offers are. And we have a fiat gateway with unlimited size wire transfers, if you're obviously KYC'd, with a minimum of 10,000 USD, Euro, GBP, or JPY. Now, this on the picture, you have an idea how our platform looks. Real simple interface. Quite light for the computer, so everybody could use it, and the API can handle more loads, of course. Going into OTC real quick, the main advantage for OTC desks, which also ties to the secondary market, is Bitfinex is just a middleman. Access to instant liquidity, you come to us, you ask, hey, I want to buy, let's say, 5,000 BTC for X amount, at X amount above or below market price, and we will try to match you with a trader. Last month, we made a decentralized OTC book where there is no middleman, there's just a contract. People can basically, if you have a seller, let's say Austin is the person that wants to buy my Ethereum, and and we agree on a price, we can make our own order book on this on-chain with no custodialship. And yeah, we can do the transfer trustless. And here a little bit about secondary market, which we are thinking of. A licensed and regulated security exchange with existing security markets on the blockchain. Licensed in the EU, and as mentioned, a regulatory market. And that's kind of introduction real quick about Bitfinex, what we do, and what we're aiming for.
Very first time I know about so much detailed introduction about Bitfinex. Everybody knows as a exchange. So now I will request Mr. Jignesh Ved, he's from Alpha Labs. If you can give introduction about your company.
Well, hi, Alpha Lab is a
Bitcoin
exchange and we are based this company, and I'm Jignesh. Yeah, I'm Jignesh here, and I'm doing consultancy into IT for the last 25 years. And the one thing I would like to tell everybody, which everybody knows rather, that only thing, you know, constant is change. And the change is, it happens because the technology keeps on evolving. And that is the reason why we have a different markets which is coming out. And people don't accept change as it is come. So that's why we have to keep on evolving the technology and give them the support and security which is required. Now, because of this, the change can be due to other reasons, like what is the challenges that we face regularly. So even the financial market, you can say traditional financial market, are already digital, but still there are no challenges, which you can see over here. There are any settlement, it requires a T+3. Then there are many intermediary like brokers, exchange, custodians, clearing house, due to which all this time is taken, and there is also a time restriction. None of these exchanges, they work 24/7. And we have, since we have so many intermediaries, we have a cost which is quite a bit high. Also, the data storage is a big question. We have reconciliation, which is very painful. So put all together, we have this challenges which we face. And of course, since there are challenges, there are always the solutions. So we have digital exchange, which actually work on digital asset-based instruments. So the best part of the digital exchange is there's the same day settlement. The digital exchanges are fully digital. That means all the custodians and clearing houses, all these things are taken care of. Best part of the digital exchange is it's 24/7. It's like you can trade all the time. Since everything is digital, everything is online, there are low trading fees. Decentralization of data storage, and hence the storage issue is being taken care of over here. And since it's a blockchain driven, reconciliation is easily taken care of over here. Alpha Lab is a multi-based company focused on development of ecosystem around virtual financial assets and distributed ledger technologies. We have also gained transitory license from MFSA for trade engines. We are partner with Circle, which is a regulatory entity for stable coin USDC, and Copper, which is regulated custodian, which is applied for FCA, and provide liquidity to other digital instruments for trade and finance. AlphaX is a blockchain platform supporting R3, Oracle, and Zinfin. The other products that we deal in is secure decentralized e-wallet, white label platform for trading digital assets. And in fact, I would like to invite everybody to register on the, here I've given the referral code where you can get $25 worth of digital tokens for registering online. Thank you.
Thank you, Jignesh. Thank you so much for giving so much insight about digital exchanges. So I will request Meng Chan Shu, and like if you can give some brief introduction about your company, it would be great.
Good afternoon. My name is Meng. Just very quickly before I begin, today there's some interesting thing that happened in the in the community. The Facebook literally published Libra white paper, 12 page. Yeah, 12 page of it. Did read just now. Didn't see much details yet. Probably they're gonna review more details. Okay, just a bit about my company, Connect Blockchain DMCC. Yeah, so Connect Blockchain DMCC was formed last year. We were quite lucky that we got the one of the proprietary trading license for crypto commodities. So we trade on our own funds, literally we were quite lucky that it was in blockchain that brought us up, and we are managing some of their crypto assets. We are also involved in the traditional commodity markets. We are market makers for Chicago Mercantile Exchange. We are market makers on the metal side, on the energy side for one of the exchange in Asia. So literally it's a bit diverse, not only on the crypto space where we market make for exchanges, as well as projects. Yeah. So literally these are what we do. The main thing is about how you set your algorithmic trading. Each exchange is different. Different exchange would have different engine, different ways of matching, and you see a lot of anomalies in different exchange platforms. Yeah, I think that's a bit about Connect Blockchain. I've been in Dubai for the last 12 years. I was with Dubai Gold and Commodities Exchange, the largest exchange, the largest commodity exchange in the Middle East. I wanted to leave a long time ago. And I think one of the reasons is that over here, I felt that there's a lot to learn. And that time, I managed to open up the Asia market for DGCX. Bringing the market share to more than 30% for Asia markets. So last year I came out to form Connect Blockchain DMCC. A bit about myself. Thanks.
Thank you, Meng Chang. That was a great impression by three of you. Now my question goes to Ken. Ken, these like three of people, they are talking about a lot about the regulations, about interactions, and like. Lots of like norms followed by them. So my question for you, what you see as a digital exchange in future, how like whether it will really replace entire traditional exchange, or like, you know, how it's evolving or from, you know, regulation point of view, what do you see from your point of view?
Well, from my point of view, there will be changes. The underlying question that doesn't often get asked is what needs to be changed. The exchanges, we're talking about digital exchanges, but digital exchanges have been around for 30 years. Okay, the online platforms have been there. I started out in this industry as an equity options specialist on the floor of the Chicago Board Options Exchange. I started in 99. And when I went down to the floor, I had a stack of paper tickets, little squares about this big. And those were the tickets that you'd write on your order information if you want to trade with somebody. The only thing we used those paper tickets for was to entertain ourselves, roll them in the paper airplanes and throw them. So in 1999, I wasn't writing down order tickets. I had a computer in my hand that I streamed all my quotes to the system, and I'd get electronic messages when the quotes would come through. Some of the unique trades would happen, and we had what we call a hybrid system. Brokers would come in, but 90% of the trading I did was through an electronic system. That was in 1999. The thing that's changing now is you're adding the operational aspects of the trade process to the ledger process. That's being digitized more. Where does the settlement occur? Where's the custody? But on the front end, things haven't really changed. Where we're looking from regulation, where you will see some changes, is more on the operational end of it. Where do we recognize settlements occurring? Who do we hold responsible for the settlement? Who's liable on settlement failure? Who's responsible for trade cancels and amends? That was much easier to know where that occurs in the previous form of the more dominant current form of the digital exchange. But the new things on the actual front of the exchange, I don't think much has changed yet. I don't see a whole lot changing. Now, we do have to recognize as regulators what is more changing in the market is who's running the exchanges, the new digital exchanges. So traditionally, there weren't that many. In a lot of jurisdictions, they were monopolies. But now with the advent of the cryptocurrencies, that has sparked the creation of a lot of digital exchanges because they fell outside the remit of a lot of regulation. And a lot of the exchanges that are building now are not regulated exchanges. And the misconception by a lot of the users is that they are regulated. As soon as you use the word exchange, you're regulated. And if it's regulated by extension, then I can trust what I trade on there. the markets that I'm trading against are monitored. Market abuse is being monitored. They assume that there is standardization across contracts, tokens across different exchanges, and they assume that they have some legal or regulatory protection if something goes wrong. So we do have to, regulations are looking at to what extent these exchanges need to be pulled into the regulatory environment. And so far there's still a lot of work that needs to be done on that, as far as understanding, as I talked about earlier, what is the underlying asset that's being traded? Is it a security or is it something else? And then there's just societal questions around, is it better to regulate something that shouldn't otherwise be regulated because consumers are at risk? Or is it just not our place to be? But to come back to how the technologies are changing the existing exchanges or conventional ones, there will be shifts in the regulation around, we expect to see around settlement and custody and how we traditionally viewed that. The regulations are rather specific around who can be a custodian. And it varies from jurisdiction to jurisdiction, but ours, for example, does require a regulated financial institution to provide that custody. Simply opening an exchange, a digital exchange, and becoming regulated doesn't necessarily qualify you as the type of financial service that's regulated that we would traditionally expect or permit to be a custodian. So there will be some changes, and it's not changes to prohibit this from happening. We're looking at how we can open it up and how we can accommodate that, but also maintain our regulatory objectives of protecting the underlying assets in whatever form they are protected. And this is where the sandboxes come in our program of letting few firms that I mentioned earlier that we have in the sandbox right now, letting them operate so we can follow the process and see where the assets begin to be recognized, where does that settlement actually occur, where is the asset, is it lying afterward being custodied? So we can review all that process, compare it to what we traditionally understood, and see how can we adjust regulation to support the new methodologies that we use, the new technologies.
Thank you, Ken. It was like a very good explanations and very, very much informative for all of us. Now, I want to start with questions from Jignesh, and then we'll go to Robert, and then... So my question is about, you know, how people, they are talking about KYC norms, like many exchanges, they provide a trading up to a certain amount without any KYC. So I just wanted to ask your opinion, how you maintain your KYC, and what are the norms you follow, take care?
Basically, the KYC norms, to follow the KYC norms, what we do is we not only take the client details on what is the rate of transactions that they are doing, but also their net worth, what kind of net worth they are being, holding it, and what is the level of leverage they can be, taking on. So basically, these are the things that we, look into. Their transaction, not only that, the transactions are, keep on monitored, like, how big is the volume ticket. It's like, we, as of now, what we do is we restrict them to a particular a level of transaction limit, and once that limit is through, they will generate some alerts. So these are the basic things that we are taking care in our platform.
Thank you. So my same questions will go to Robert, and I want Robert to give some detailed explanation about KYC, the way you give an introduction about Bitfinex.
All right. So in regards to KYC, you can just make an account with us. We won't require you to do KYC at the start. However, if we see those source, there's an insane amount of coins coming in to your account and you've never traded, and all of a sudden that stuff goes into a privacy coin, you won't be able to withdraw without any KYC. You have to do KYC with us. And our KYC is really strict. We will ask up to the most absurd questions of, show me your employment contract, how you made that money. And if you come,
how you communicate, it's a scan copy, or you do calls, or how it goes?
The process is for everybody is different. Also, how believable is your story? Because if you tell us, I did a job in 2013 and I got paid in Bitcoin, where we can check on the chain that those coins come from a stolen wallet or from a wallet that's under investigation, we won't let you withdraw unless you provide us enough evidence that you're the owner. And if it's stolen funds, yeah, you know, that will be reported. But in regards to KYC, you know, from scanned documents to signing to just everything you would need to open a bank account, we require that, and probably even more. We will ask you a utility bill, phone bill, insurance, proof of address, proof of funds. Like, we will check everything to make sure that we comply with the SEC, well, even with all economics and standards.
Great. Thank you, Robert, for giving such a good insight about KYC. Now, same questions go to Meng Chansu about like how you take care of KYC when users create an account.
I think for users to create account, the main thing is withdrawals, more towards the withdrawal side rather than putting funds in. Withdrawals are more important because you will know where the end destination is, and it's like what Robert said, the end destination you will be able to track as well,
right,
from that perspective.
And what about, you know, like incoming, like how they got different, like Robert explained, like they would go for like employment pass and all the details. So how do you track that the fund came from very authorized source?
For us, like example, when we market make for projects or when we market make for exchanges, for projects, literally the KYC belongs to the project owners. So the account basically we manage on their behalf.
Ken, now it's your turn. Like, you listen to three of them, they talk about KYC. I just need your like prospects where you know what is like else can be done to add more transparency in KYC. If you can give us some more detail, like what they should follow.
Well, it sounds like generally they're doing the right thing in the right way. It's a difficult question necessarily to ask. You have to know who your client is. You've got to be able to verify them. How you go about doing that is going to be up to each, you know, each institution to figure out what's the best way to do that based on the profile the client they deal with. And the only piece that I didn't hear a whole lot about was that underlying assessment of the client. The one different element of this is that the assessment of the client happens before the transactions. Now it's finally onboard a client before you deal with them. But you need to have some sense of what the risk profile is of that client so that you can make a judgment call on the transaction as to whether or not that transaction is unusual for that client. Now, it's another thing in the Bitcoin world, the blockchain world, where you can track back to an origination point that in itself is suspect. But if you don't have that, how do you identify activity that is suspicious because of that client himself? What's unusual for that client? So that's another aspect.
If I may comment on this, I know, like, for example, if let's just call the trader Josh, normally trades between 1,000 and 5,000 positions, all of a sudden takes a position of 500,000, that does get flagged in the system. I guess that's what you're, or wash trading on illiquid pairs. We are partnered with Erisium, which is market surveillance, which also helps us track these kind of things. In to, you know, to answer your question in regards to risk profile.
Now the next question is about AML things. You know, whether to do AML at the starting of like onboarding at the time of customer, whenever they are creating a login, that is the time when you do AML, or like how process you follow first will go from Robert.
So AML is really where do the funds go to at the end. Like, I'm gonna look at a perspective where, okay, you know, you're KYC or you've proven, and then you're initiated withdrawal to, let's say, a sanctioned country. Your withdrawal will not be processed just because it's a sanctioned country, which would be against the law to process the withdrawal.
Okay. So, your opinion?
In trading,
people like talks about, you know, action, that means like most of the action they do more like money laundering and like people use. So I just wanted your prospect to make it more clear. It's not only about like, you know, AML. How
sure.
You take care of AML part.
Trading about 20 exchanges, actually is quite important. It's really, it hurts to say that not many exchanges really have a stringent KYC AML process. From the trader's perspective, I think a few things that we always look to consider. Number one is, if the exchange is the gatekeeper, obviously they will be putting all the AML requirements or KYC requirements on board. But it still depends on who the user is, what they want to do it. Yeah. So it really depends the user, not so much about the exchange. Selecting exchange is very tough. There are not many good exchanges. I mean, there are like more than 10,000 exchanges.
Right.
Selecting exchanges is really difficult. Different exchange would have different requirements. Some is really lenient. Just take a photo, passport. Some is a little bit more. They require a bit of a proof of address. Some, they require a bit of bank statements. So it really depends on exchanges. That is the first gatekeeper, I guess.
Great. Jignesh, you can give your prospects on AML part, then we can ask opinion from Ken and Coghill.
Basically, what we do is there is profiling of whether it's individual or institutional, and based on that, whatever KYC that we have received based on that, as well as we also do a risk profiling on which are there any, you know, sanctioned parties which are being involved in the transactions, or whether it's any country-based sanctions are there on the, you know, transactions. So putting all together, it's like basically we do is a risk profiling at a very granular level, right from, you know, individual to the transaction level, like what kind of transactions they are going through.
Okay, great. Thank you. So now, Ken, please, if you can give us some more insight about, you know, AML, the same.
So just to read a little bit on what our expectations are, it changes from jurisdiction to jurisdiction. There are variations. Most jurisdictions that are, most are FATF compliant.
Based on that underlying profile. That's the most difficult part. It's not easy to decide what risk a client should be. The regulator won't tell you that. We might disagree with you if we look at your client files and ask, well, how is it you can tell us that this client is low risk for financial crime when this is the background he told you that you have? We'll question it. We can't tell you what it is. It's based on your own